Gerald Turney, your instructor. And today we've got a really good show, I think. It's the last show of the semester. And we'll be back in January for the spring quarter or semester. We are live and interactive. You can call us with your questions at 1-800-339-1193. We take questions on anything about gardening and gardens in general, from apples to zinnias and freaks to turf. If you've got a question about your garden, give us a call, and I'll do my best to answer your question and direct you where you can find your answer. Now, we always like to start the show with upcoming events. There's a lot of things happening in the winter months, a lot of fun stuff. Now, they always have a Thursday garden talk every month in, at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. So theirs will be December 10th this month from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. I'm not sure who the speaker will be this time, but it's always an excellent speak or talk. You can call 626-405-3571 to find out who's speaking and get any more additional information you need. In addition to the garden talk and plant sale at the Huntington, we have the Viewing Stone Show at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, December 6th through January 2nd. These viewing stones are really wonderful. They can look like different things. They can look like mountains. They can look like an island. And that will be a really, really nice show to attend and see the rest of the gardens as well. There's a lot of things coming in bloom at the Huntington right now. In addition to the Viewing Stone Show, Garden Lights at the San Diego Botanic Garden. This was formerly known as Whale Botanical Gardens, December 10th through the 23rd, and the 26th through the 30th. This is an evening show, and it's really spectacular, a wonderful event for the whole family. Call 760-436-3036 for more information. In addition to that, we've got the late fall and winter garden walks at Rancho Santa Ana Botanical Gardens, December 26th. 1 to 3 p.m. You need to call 909-625-8767 for more information and to let them know you're coming. These type of events get filled up, and so you want to make sure there's room for you and that they know you're intending to come. Rancho Santa Ana Botanical Garden is all native plants from the California Forest Province. So there's a lot of things that are starting to bloom that are California native, so that'll be a really wonderful walk. You can see a lot of natives planted in the landscape. In addition to that, we've got the Horticultural Symposium and Camellia Flower Show coming up on January 9th at Descanso Gardens. And in fact, there will be four Camellia Flower Shows at Descanso Gardens throughout the winter months, January and February, which is the peak bloom for camellias. You can call 818-949-4200 for more information about getting to Descanso Gardens in their interest fee. Now, if we have any more, is we have the Horticultural Spotlight Rose Pruning Demonstration at Descanso Gardens on January 9th as well. So give them a call, and I believe you'll probably need to reserve a spot to attend the Rose Pruning Demonstration. And of course, Rose Pruning is coming up. It's really done between December 15th and February 15th. You need to prune them down, and so you want to see exactly how to get that done. This would be a great venue to find that type of information. So, we have the Great Rose Areas of the World. Now, this is an all-day event at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, a group of people, experts speaking on roses. It's January 23rd and 24th. There is a fee to attend. And if you're a real rose enthusiast and you want to get the latest information, find out about the latest varieties that are being introduced, you can give them a call at 626-405-3507. Claire Martin, of course, is the Rose Curator at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, and he's organized this event. It's an annual event. They bring in some of the top rose breeders around the United States and probably have the international rose breeders. It's just an excellent two-day symposium on roses. We also have in addition to the earlier Camellia Flower Show at Descanso's Gardens, there's a Camellia Flower Show on January 16th and 17th at Descanso. And this is one of the four Canadian Flower Show, so they own the Wisconsin Gardens. So, and those Canadian Flower Shows are absolutely breathtaking. If you haven't been to one of the Flower Shows, they fill up the entire hall with blooms. You'll see more blooms for Canadian flowers at one of those shows than you can see in months of walking through the gardens, because all the enthusiasts bring their flowers in to compete for prizes. And it's really, really something you should do at least once and see the wide variety of blooms from the little tiny miniatures to the very large reticulatas. So I strongly encourage you to try and get up to Wisconsin, or Huntington also has a flower show, which will probably be later in the season. Now, there's a couple of things I want to talk about today. Our main lecture will be on bromeliads, and so if you enjoy bromeliads, we'll be talking about them. But before we move on to bromeliads, I want to show you a few things and talk about a few things that are timely. First is, I want to show you something, and this, the real point of this is not just to show you an interesting disease, but to show you that everyone learns something, no matter how old. They say that you can't teach an old dog new tricks, but I'm an old dog, and I learn new things all the time. Now, actually, in the past few years, I collected this sample. This is a branch from Chinese elm. And it has these very large cankers. And you can see right here is the bark that is not infected. And then right in here, you can see these very large cankers. They flip this around. This is a canker. This is infected by a fungus. And I collected this in Long Beach. This is the trees. The trees have these type of cankers up in the upper large scaffolds and the smaller branches. And I wasn't familiar with this disease, and I wasn't able to diagnose it. And then just this last week, an arborist came by with some other problems that he was having with different trees. And I showed him these branches, and he said, "Well, that's black spot." I knew black spot on Chinese elm as a leaf spot, like an anthracnose. And in fact, it also gets into the wood and causes these large cankers. And so it was almost a revelation to me. I hadn't heard that. I looked it up in one of my texts, and it mentions that Chinese elm will grow right along the coast, where it's very cool and wet, can develop these large cankers from the black spot fungus. Now, typically, what you'll get is in red springs, you'll get black spots on the leaves of the Chinese elms. And that can cause the tree to foliate and drop its leaves, very similar to the anthracnose diseases. You get on things like sycamore, and you get anthracnose on oaks. Wide variety of trees, and it's actually of all the fungi are actually different fungi, so the same fungus infecting all those different trees. And they're actually very close to the same fungi that cause these anthracnose diseases. But it is true here, the black spot on the Chinese elm is going to be so well. Chinese elm, maybe some other elms are also susceptible. But here in Southern California, we'll see on the Chinese elm. But I just wanted to share that with you, and often I talk about cankers and canker diseases on trees. This is an excellent example of a canker, and a very severe canker. Unfortunately, there are no treatments. It's too extensive in the canopy. You can't treat cankers by just getting out and treating them for the pace if they're small cankers. So, I just wanted to share that with you. I learned something new. I learned things new as often as I can. Often I get presented with the same problems quite frequently. So it seems like I may know a whole lot, but I know a thimble full compared to all the information that is out there on plants, plant diseases, and how to take care of them. Now, sampling some nurseries, part of my full-time job with the Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture. I run the Plant Diagnostic Laboratory in South Bay, Plant Pathologies. And I was up at the nursery, and every year they bring in a whole bunch of plant seeds. I just had to talk about plant seeds. They're so beautiful and they're so much fun. I buy some every winter, and some of my mom and some of my friends. They really kind of have become associated very strongly with Christmas. And they're red and green, of course, they're Christmas colors. Now, a lot of people may not realize that these red leaves are not the flowers. This is not the flower. Flower is right here, these very, very small flowers. And these favorite characteristic of the genus that is the common platform character condition phobia plus one. And as the ivy forms, they have this type of flower where they form that this is characteristic. These flowers right here are very, this is the phobia flower. And a lot of phobias are sepals from Africa. Poinsettia, of course, is in Mexico. And in Mexico, where it grows, it doesn't look like this at all. The wild form is actually to be very tall and leggy and have very small bracts and not be very showy. But these are hybridized and developed, especially by the Ekithin, over many, many years. And so now they have really kind of, you know, a wide variety of colors: white, pink, orange, red. And of course, they are forest blue. They are short egg plants, which means that when you short egg long night, that causes them to bloom. And in this, they get a greenhouse where they fill in the whole greenhouse with frames, turn off lights, fire a minimum number of hours of darkness to cause the plant to bloom. Even if light that sneaks in, if you go in and turn on the light and turn it off, it'll disrupt that flower. The plant will respond instantly to just a little tiny bit of light, and it'll disrupt the bloom. So they have to turn absolutely dark for a minimum number of hours. If they start it in fall, it's before the morning bloom. Now these normally will not do well once planted out in the garden. They'll revert to being rather tall and leggy. And they won't bloom at Christmas, they bloom later, they'll bloom in January, February. And they are fairly tender too. So if we get a really hard freeze, get down into the 20s, it will certainly kill them. But a wonderful plant to grow for Christmas, they're not particularly expensive. This one was about $5. I'm not a perfect florist, but I stopped at and picked up a few. So it's really fun. I have a couple of people sitting around my house, and it just makes me feel like it's Christmas. So it's one of my favorite plants. And just a couple more notes on this. They really have a hard time with the temperatures down below 50 degrees. So it's not, well, it's not a great plant for the interior valleys, but it will do okay if you plant it outside along the coast where it stays quite a bit warmer, except in the winter months. Even if it's really hot, it doesn't leak to me either. So, it is named after Joel Roberts Poinsett, who was the first United States Minister to Mexico. He introduced the plant to the United States in 1828. So Poinsett is a new girl in the United States for a long time. But they didn't become really associated with Christmas until the Ecky family started promoting it and hybridizing them and developing all the new colors. And of course, they're now very bushy too. And often you'll find on some, if they've been pinched a lot in order to make them bushier, you get a lot more flowers but smaller bracts. And if they don't pinch them, you get fewer flowers but bigger bracts. So there's a little difference there. For me, but that's like that big difference. Whether you're finished or not finished, it's just really, really pretty. Now, one other plant I wanted to share with you real quick was this. I actually brought it on the show a couple weeks ago, and it was had buds on it, and now flowers have opened. This is an orchid that I've been growing in my greenhouse window for a while. It bloomed for me the first time I saw it bloom. This is actually a hybrid of four different genera. And it's called Pinnaloa, is the common name of the cultivar. What I find from in my orchids to rebloom is they need a lot of bright light, and I need to keep them moist. I water them sometimes, about 3 times a week in the summer months because my house gets quite warm. But this will do really well for me. You can see that here's the old bulb, and here's the new bulb. And of course, the new bulb has thrown the new flower spike. And here's another new bulb coming up right here. And so, if I can keep this healthy, and not let it dry out too much, I have to fertilize fairly frequently and keep getting them going. particularly it's going to tell me it's not watering properly. The bulbs will say a plop and they won't shrivel. So if I see the bulbs are starting to shrivel on any of my orchids, whether it's tomatoes, in this case this is a forager or a hybrid, if I see that the bulbs are shriveling, I know that I'm not watering quite enough. So a lot of my tomatoes do shrivel because unfortunately I have a hard time keeping up with having too many siblings in the backyard. So that's really pretty. I just had to share that with you. Now the other thing I want to lecture about a little more in depth are bromeliads. And they are the family bromeliades. And we'll bring up our first photograph just to show you what they look like. If you're not familiar with bromeliads, they have a cup. And all that's required is to keep that cup full of water. They have a lot of habitats, and mostly they're subtropical. And they include both the epiphytes and, of course, spanish moss, which is Dicerandia. And that is grown to the southern United States. And there are closer species as well. And pineapple is the bromeliad. So it's a pretty big family with a wide variety of plants, both the ones that grow on trees that you can just tie onto a branch or tie onto a stone. And just keep watering the cup, and it'll do quite well. And this cup can be referred to as a tank. I've got one right here. They're often brightly colored. As you can see, this one has a nice bright red center. If we can take a look from the top, I want to there you can see that this is already bloomed. And it's got it's nicely variegated in the leaf, but the center, of course, is bright red. This is one of the plants that you can use that will give you color continuously rather than just a short blooming period. Any plot of flowers or plants bloom and then you don't get any bloom again for a year. But this one, this particular species, flowers deep in the tank. It's hard to see. There's the fluorescence deep in here. Others sit down very long fluorescences. This is Samba. We'll talk about this more later, but I just want to show you this is a typical tank. You just keep watering here. And of course, what you need to do is throw pumps or small plantlets off the base, and those can be broken off and potted, and you can propagate them quite easily. Now, Tillandsia is a really nice genus within the bromeliad family. And we can look at photograph number two, and I'll show you a Tillandsia tree, or tower, I should say. It's many different species of Tillandsia that have been attached to this piece of wood with bark. And all these roots and these trees, Tillandsia are photosynthetic and get all their water nutrients from the air. And they have trichomes that attach them to their substrate so they can hang. And of course, the Spanish moss is the Tillandsia species. We are live and on the air, so if you have a question, you can call at 1-800-339-1193. Any question you have about your garden, and I'll try to help you out. Now, there's a really interesting bromeliad called Puya, and I want to bring up the picture number three. And let's bring this up full screen. And the flowers on this are actually a turquoise metallic color. And it's a large clump, 3 to 4 meters in height. So that would be up to 12 feet tall. And they have a spike that will stick up 9 to 10 meters tall. And this is a pool. Bertaronia, and there's a large clump of them at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. And when they bloom, they're absolutely spectacular. I've never seen this color in a flower before. So you really need to try and get by and see when they're blooming. You can see in this picture. Let's bring that up again. I want to point out one more thing about this picture. Let's bring this up. see these appendages right here. Those are actually perches for birds to sit on and stick their beaks down in there and get nectar. So they actually come with their own little stand. Now, if we bring up four, we'll take a look at pineapple. And pineapple is bromeliad. This is the inflorescence. Actually, the fruit after the inflorescence. Everyone's familiar with pineapples. They're widely grown in Brazil and throughout South America. So, the largest, is a species of Peru. The greatest number for this species reside in the Andean Highlands. They're native mostly to South America. And so it's believed that they originated in the Andes. There are some African species as well, West African species. There's only one species, I should say, native to Africa. Pitacanaria feliciana is the only one not endemic to America. So it's not endemic to Africa. Via some type of long distance dispersal, probably millions of years ago. Humans have been using bromeliads for many thousands of years. The Incas, the Aztecs, and the Maya used them for food and protection and fiber, and also in ceremonies. European interest began with the Spanish conquistadors, or the Spanish travelers who came to the Americas and found them. Returned to the Europe with pineapple, which became a very popular as an exotic food, and was adapted into European art and sculpture. In 1776, the species Fusariaria lingulata was introduced to Europe, which caused a sensation among gardeners on flowers such as the plant. And we can take a quick look at this metaphor on picture number five. And this is typical of many of the bromeliads. The flower itself is not all that spectacular, but it's the leaves surrounding the flower that develop the bright colors. And so this is Fusariaria. And this was one of the very first bromeliads species introduced into Europe in the 1700s. Now in 1820, Achillea fasciata was brought to Europe. And we can take a look at that in photograph number six. There it is. This is actually probably the most common bromeliad you see now. I've grown this particular species for a long time. And after that, Vericea was brought into Europe. And these transplants were very successful. And they're still the most widely grown bromeliad species today. Now, Achillea fasciata is also known as the silver vase of the urn plant. And it's probably the best known of all the different species of bromeliads. I'm sure many of you have seen it before. Often used as a house plant. It grows fairly slowly, only reaching about 1 to 3 feet in height. And it's buried at about 2 feet. And of course, it freely produces pups or small plants off the base. It has rather elliptic, oval shaped leaves that are between 18 to 36 inches in length. And of course, it's a basic rosette, so it's a circular pattern of leaves. It requires partial shade and well drained but moist retentive soil, so we want a nice potting soil, sandy loam or loam. It can be grown epiphytically, as for example, with moss around its roots and wire to rough bark, especially if you keep that tank full of water. There aren't too many serious pests of this. You can get root rot if you keep it, the soil too wet. And I have seen things like mealy bugs on them, but they're easily washed off. Skin insects could be a problem, and of course, mosquitoes occasionally can be found reproducing or living in the tank itself. So you might occasionally want to dump out the tank and get rid of any mosquitoes. Now, I have a short clip on bromeliads that I'd like to, a video clip from YouTube that I'd like to show you. And when we come back, we'll have our guest, and he's a very special guest. And I'm really excited that he's able to come on the show today. And he is, of course, an expert on bromeliads. So let's go to our video clip. Yeah, we'll have our guests.
Still benefiting from being outdoors during summer months in a bright shady garden. Some of these plants lack more moisture than others. Some of the varieties with more of a waxy coating to the leaf but more of a grayer color can take a drier environment. And some of the varieties with a shinier or glossier greener leaf may mean they lack a higher humidity. You can miss the foliage and the humidifier in the room. All of those things really will help. Most Romanians really like bright light. They're considered epiphytes. Many of them grow on tree branches in the tropics, in the rainforest. Some even grow on rocks. Send an email me a gardening question to this station. I'll try to answer it next time.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. And today we have a wonderful guest who has one of the most interesting nurseries I've ever been in. So today our guest is Paul Isley. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. Oh, good. So let's introduce Paul. Paul, you own or co-owner of Rainforest Flora Nursery in the Tampa Garden.
Correct.
Down in Torrance. You're on top of this floor 190. And I remember the first time I came to the nursery, it blew my mind. I've never seen a nursery take such a large portion of your growing area and turn it into a botanical garden.
Well, we were lucky because we have been doing this for 35 years now. And so the wholesale part of the business really drove the construction of the front greenhouse. If it was just for retail, yes, we would not have been able to do what we did, but with the wholesale distribution through the depots and the nursery chains, the grocery store chains, and all of that, we were able to build this really wonderful.
Yeah, you know, I'm familiar with Goy. You got those, are those quotes?
The new book here has a picture of one of the waterfalls, the big rocky waterfalls, the pines and stuff, and it turned out to be terrific. I mean, you don't know when you're building something like that how it's going to turn out, but we did our best with it, and the plants have turned out to just love it. We've been there for 10 years now, and they've just grown in. The tillandsia seeds are naturalizing on the bars and stuff.
Oh, that's really true. This is successful when you get your plants to actually reproduce on their own.
Yeah, it's like being in nature.
So you have a new book on tillandsia.
Yes, I actually just got back from Asia. I was over there for a
week. I told this out there and show it on one of these cameras. Which camera do you want to look at? Here it is.
I was there for 2.5 weeks and we spent a week in a place called Guangdong in Guangdong province in China. And I'm glad I was there to oversee it. People were great. The eight color state of the art Heidelberg Press was fantastic. This book is the culmination of the last 22 years since the first book that I did was out, and that's been out of print now for many years, and it's very expensive on the internet. So there's a big need for a new book, and I'm really, really glad it's done.
How many different species of tillandsia do you grow?
If you include not only the species, but the cultivars and the hybrids, I would guess there are maybe 300 or 400.
So you got a pretty good collection. I was just out at Corrier for you. During the week, they just placed it in this app like I always do. And he mentioned that you were so well known for your plants.
Well, we've been doing it 35 years, which is longer than anybody else. And we have our two main growing nurseries down in North County, San Diego. And that's where we produce the tillandsias because they take from 6 to 25 years to grow from seeds.
Oh, I didn't realize it was so long.
Yeah, the process is a very long process. They have 2 or 3 kilos, most otherwise they're the greatest plants on earth. I mean, they vary more in shape, color, and size from species to species within the same genus than any other plants on earth by far.
Is Spanish moss the smallest of all the varieties that I read that?
Probably the smallest, yeah, probably the smallest.
But of course, they grow long,
right?
How would you call it a long chain?
It grows into a tall, long clump in one generation. It actually just grow down like this, and I've got pictures in the book. But we made a hybrid of it actually with a species called Recurvata, which also grows. the south, and you see it growing on the power lines and tree trunks and surround the tufty thing, rather than the long, stringy Spanish moss. You combine those two, and you get one called Atlantic Kimberly, and it is a beautiful bunch clump that gets about 2 feet or so, and it's real thick, and that's turned out to be really popular as well. So we actually grow the Spanish moss. We now have three different kinds, and we had one kind, you know, years and years ago, and I found a really interesting form in Paraguay years ago. And, you know, as bromeliads are endemic to the Western Hemisphere, they came in since the last time the continent split apart, so they only occur in the Western Hemisphere. And so they're probably the newest plants on Earth. Bromeliads and cacti are both pretty much
the only thing you're talking about. Also,
yeah,
only occur in the Americas.
Yeah, they each have one species that's in Africa, but basically they're both New World plants.
They also sensational with their interest in Europe.
Oh, yeah, yeah, they did. And, especially the pineapple, if you were talking
yeah,
about
earlier. So, yeah,
they were worth their weight in gold when they started.
All that, you know, I carried the collection at the London for a few years and became very familiar with the place. When tea was introduced into Europe, it was extremely expensive, 50 pounds for an ounce. And they kept it in gold and silver chalices. And of course, they had that whole period of explorers going around the world looking for all these plants, and they brought them into Europe. People were really excited about all the different plants, and I see you brought us a nice collection of different materials here.
Well, I brought different plants this and I said some of we can talk about. I think one for the day is the idea we're just talking about some of the history of these plants, and I have a chapter in the book that's dedicated to the biographical history of the plants, because guys like Linnaeus and von Humboldt, these people over the centuries discovered these plants, they love them, they named a bunch of them. And when I did the book, I wanted to show that there's a vertical history to these plants as well. It's not like they're brand new, although they are for most people, but there are a number of people who have been into them for centuries now. Linnaeus described the first Tillandsia in 1737. He erected the genus of Tillandsia in 1753. And von Humboldt a whole bunch in the early 1800s, and they've been going on ever since. And what's different now, besides the fact that there are many more described species, somewhere, you know, 600 or 700 described species, what we've focused on for the last few years is growing the plants and making hybrids, because Tillandsia exhibit tremendous hybrid vigor.
Oh, okay, so you're crossing with the genus.
Right.
And with some species are more difficult to grow.
Well, there are 6 or 7 subgenera of Tillandsia, and you don't want to get too far into taxonomy because they've got some fighting for what's what, but right now there are 6 or 7 different subgenera of Tillandsia, and within a subgenus you can hybridize pretty easily because the plants are so new, they're readily able to be hybridized, and when you grow a hybrid, get a plant that has much larger inflorescence. It's a much bigger plant than either parent. This is a perfect example here. This is a hybrid of Strigia and Recurvifolia, and the individual plants are much larger than either parent. You can see how large the inflorescences are on this plant, larger than either parent.
One of the things I love is they incorporate it, they do it just so they get all their nutrition usually in water from the air.
Well, they get it through the leaves, which comes from the air.
It's the how do they get nutrition? Is it just from dust?
Well, Tillandsia is a term, the botanical term is oligotrophic. Oligotrophic means that they get a lot of mileage out of very little fertilizer. They grow high on trees and cliffs in nature. They don't get a lot of fertilizer, and so they absorb it from the dust in the air, and when they get water from rain and things like that. So one of the strategies that they've used to be able to survive in environments where they don't have roots in sandy soil, where they get a lot of nutrients and things like that, is they grow more slowly. They don't get as large. They have the white fuzz on the leaves of many of these plants, which reflects a lot of the extra sunlight that hits them and things like that. So they've developed these strategies to be able to survive in environments where there aren't other plants. The Tillandsia is one of the prize for the composition for space to grow. If you look at the Amazon, if you look at a rainforest, restored deep jungle and everything's crawling on everything else, fighting for space. These guys have been able to go out into the desert regions of Latin America where there isn't any competition and take over growing on cliffs and high in trees and cacti, and so they have lots and lots of room to grow. And to do that, they've adapted these modifications to their biology so that they can thrive in these what we would consider to be harsh environments.
You want to do lichens a little bit?
Yeah, lichens, you know, they're fine in a lot of different places. You know, one of the neat things about it, I call them tombstones. We don't put too many nicknames on the plants that, like coffee, Starburst, or something like that. We tend to contract the actual name, so it's as it becomes tilling. Xerographic, it becomes Xero, you know, things like that.
This is
a different subgenus. This is subgenus Tillandsia, which is mostly in Central America. The previous line was subgenus Onopophytum, which is down more in Brazil, Argentina, South America, down there. But, yes, they're in the same genus, and this is another one here called Bulbosa, and I'm not sure what the camera's on, but.
This one is really unusual.
Yes, it's very, very unusual. And both of those plants are the same subgenus. You can see how different looking they are from each other. And yet, they're as closely related as two plants can be and still be different.
You can hybridize them.
And you can hybridize them too. We haven't done that one yet. That would actually be a really neat one. When you're holding in your hand, Bulbosa, in nature, it blooms and grows along river banks and trees that are bright green. So when it blooms, it turns a brilliant red and attracts hummingbirds to pollinate it. Which is really fun to see if you're going along the river banks, say down Guatemala somewhere, and you're looking at the banks and they're just green. Then wherever these plants are blooming, they stand out like a sore thumb. Some hummingbirds come swimming in, and they put on brakes and they go over and they see, you know, because they see the plants and they go over and they pollinate the plants. And that's a strategy that was evolved. This is a hybrid, but it also, when the plants just turn red like that, is to attract the hummingbirds to pollinate.
So are hummingbirds the primary pollinator?
Exactly. Yeah, they're the primary pollinator. There are a number of species that have really wonderfully fragrant flowers.
Will they attract insects in the fragrant
flowers? Well, they do. I mean, if I ants on the ants are one of the beans of life, right? If I ants on their butt, and then they bring the scale and feel bugs, but ants are all over the flowers a lot, but the main pollinators for the fragrant blooming species are the moths and butterflies, because they're attracted to scent, whereas the hummingbirds are more attracted to color.
And red is the primary.
And primary red is primary. But from my observations in the nurseries, because the hummingbirds will fly into the greenhouses and pollinate the plants and build their nests in the plants. If people like hummingbirds, these are fantastic plants, because once you have a few of them hanging around, you won't need your feeders anymore. You just hang, and the hummers will come and they'll get pollen and nectar from the plants and rebloom, and they'll build their nests in the plants a lot of times. And it's really fun to watch, and it's more of a natural thing. But a lot of these fermers, like I said, the hummingbirds I've noticed will pretty much hit on anything that moves. I mean, really not discriminatory. They just go after everything. I mean, is it even afraid of moving? Is it one of your hybrids? I have this. It's an Onyantha hybrid. I'm not sure what the other parent is. It's a beautiful plant. I grab a few plants to bring in the show. And
this is just one of the guys looking all this
Bulbosa.
How old is this?
I actually sowed the seeds in those 1993. That was the last big trip that I went on, was 1993. And all the plants we got pretty much sat on the tarmac in Guatemala and rotted. But we did get the seeds. We started growing them from seeds in 1993. And for the last 3 or 4 years, different ones have been coming into bloom.
So you just want to see this in 1993, so this plant is
16 years old.
Yeah.
You know, and when we sell these in the stores, they're more expensive than a lot of the bedding plants and things that take a couple, 3 weeks to grow, and grow. Or let's say, on average, probably 10, 12 years to grow. But it really takes a long time. And so that's why sometimes they cost a little bit more. But gosh, look what you can get. A plant that doesn't need dirt, they'll take temperatures down to freezing. As long as they get enough light and they get water, they're great. You go on vacation for a month, come back, they'll still be there. And another really cool thing about these plants is that of all of them, they can dry out. And if they dry out, what happens is the leaf edges will start to pinch up and curl up. And they'll get tighter and tighter and tighter as the plants get overly dry. So if you take the plant and put it underwater overnight, you'll rehydrate it. And you can't do that with orchids. You can't do that with most other plants, and these don't have
plants. We're going to talk about plants here. There's the arborvitaes. There's a lot of arborvitaes there too.
The more commercial types you see in the stores with the green leaves and the spice, those are the most tender. But they do great in people's houses, you know, and the other arborvitaes are wonderful for people who want to decorate a space. You know, of all the plants you can buy, all the plants that are out there, those kinds of arborvitaes have the most color. They last the longest and they're the largest for the price of anything you can get. You know, they'll last 2, 3, 4, 5 months. And so if you have a corner where you want to have a live plant with lots of color to decorate, then that's why the arborvitaes are so great.
They start to gear out a little bit. They usually will throw some pups.
They'll throw pups and you can grow them out in the patio. That's when you want to put them out in the patio and try and grow them. Most of you will just go buy a new one.
Well, what I did was, you know, I was just out before we move on to your place, I'll just show you something I bought from you at your nursery a while ago. Now, I think I'm pronouncing the genus wrong. It's
Frisia.
Okay,
yeah, forget the Fris.
And so this bloom, it was beautiful. The bottom bloom, this is the old one. And you can see, if you look at it, you can see the old plant. So, 1, 2, 3 new pups. And I bought 2 of them actually.
Yeah.
And I pulled all the pups off the other one just maybe, 3 or 4 weeks ago. And potted them up. And now this is hard rooted.
Yeah, but it is too. It's going to be rooted pretty fast.
Well, it has rooted too much.
It's right now. It's got a couple of roots here.
Sorry, my favorite root right there. I pulled it off because I was fun to show it. But take a quick look at this. It's already starting to grow new roots in just a few weeks. And how long will it take for this to bloom?
Probably the next spring if it's in good conditions, yeah.
And they like bright light. They don't need to take the direct sun.
Just a little bit, yeah. Green soft leaf plants will burn in sun. The soft green leaf plants, that's like red skin. And if you get to the gray, harder, stiffer leaf, covered with white trichomes like this, it's like black skin. So these plants can take a lot more light than these plants can.
So this can take early morning sun, especially
for an hour or so.
Is this tender? How much?
Well, I don't know if they're all the way to freezing.
Yeah, so.
But they're pretty tough.
They'll survive down into the 40s, maybe in the 30s.
Sure.
But if you get a hard freeze, you should bring them in.
Definitely bring them in.
Okay, so I'm going to bring mine in.
There, on this little guy here, what you can do is you can take even on this center, you can feel like the center plant is real similar to what it is. And if it's not real attached, you can do a little twist to take it out. This one's still pretty attached, so I've you can take some scissors and just go in there and just snip it off at the base. Let's see, look right here. You can snip that off right there at the base, and then you would have the pretty beautiful plants that you grow up and plant. Love the plants that you want.
I really like about bromeliads is that when I buy one, I'm going to get more.
Yes. And it's refreshing to drown it.
Well, here's the funny thing. I didn't bring one with me. I think it's a little dark at home. And I have a whole bunch of them, but it got to the point that I had time to buy everything you can think of. And then I got a dog. And they wanted to chew that plant. And no matter what I did, they would drag it out onto the lawn. And thus would chew them up. And so I have them high enough and I'm kind of thinking good, but they kind of came down a little bit there.
That's what he's very much high. You don't know why. Some dogs won't do things. Sometimes cats do things and sometimes they don't. I'll tell you, when you're going around different countries in Latin America, and you're out in, we're set up a little bit. I don't put up the book and show pictures of what they look like growing on cacti and stuff in the deserts and different trees, but the goats get everything from about 8 feet down. I don't know how they get that high, but you have a cliff that'll be solid with a ton of it. It'll come right down 8 feet and then nada. They just get
moved through the tortoise for 8 years.
They move off.
I actually briefly had a baby goat when I was in the river, so it was kind of a funny experience. I had it for about 30 days and then I just said, I can't keep this goat.
It's
it was fun for a lot of work, but then I realized it was eating all the plants in the yard. So, So I make a choice in my garden or my room.
That was an easy one.
Now, those are most of the plants these have this type of arrangement in their blossom.
Yeah, this is a long, it's a spike. And with a lot of them, you do, but then there's one that doesn't. You do have species that don't really have an inflorescence. The flowers just, they come out in the, they come out just in the center.
I don't know if they can tell me if you're above our heads, too.
Okay.
So here's the
flowers. If the flowers just come out from within the middle of the plant, there really is no scape, which is what you would call xerographic. So it's interesting, for instance, when you create a hybrid with a plant that does not have an inflorescence, something this idea of the hybrid here, unfortunately that trait is dominant. So if you cross one that doesn't have an inflorescence that sticks out with one that does, the one that doesn't dominates. So you lose most of your inflorescence. What's nice is that those that don't have an inflorescence also are the ones that turn bright red a lot of times.
So they interfere with the
plant. Yeah, and they will transfer that color to the hybrid. So the hybrid, even though it doesn't have the same grand inflorescence, the leaves themselves will be beautiful red, and that makes up for it.
Well, in fact, just a few weeks ago, I was talking about color in the garden, and that it's hard to keep color in your garden with just flowers,
right?
Many plants bloom for maybe a couple weeks, up to a month, maybe, if you're lucky. And you can get a lot more color in your garden with foliage. One of the things that I grow is colors, from seed.
Yeah.
And you get this huge array of different colors just from one little seed bag. And you can put it on the spray, and you have color all the way to the fall from.
Yes,
they're great. And they're a lot of fun, they're easy to grow. And right now, what I'm doing is I'm going around a lot of them and cutting in the broodium. And I'm bringing them indoors and putting them back out in the spring.
And they'll just keep going.
And they keep going.
It's a real funny anecdote. I never told this before. Reminded me that when I started the business and brought some of these plants back up from Latin America and I started taking them around to different nurseries to sell them, nobody had ever seen these before, they had no idea what they were. And so therefore it would take a certain amount of courage on the part of the person that owned the nursery to try and
go absolutely.
And a lot of times they wouldn't even want to talk to you. So I did grow a bunch of coleus with seeds and I put them in 6-inch clay pots and they were beautiful and everybody knew what coleus were, so I could take those into the nursery and show them and say, oh, by the way, look at these, you know, pull up something like this, you know. And that's how I started getting the plants into the nurseries back in the mid-70s.
So, what was your background with plants? Did you go to school or did you have yourself come?
Well, I went to college at UCLA and I had a herpetology class and the TA in that class and I got to be good friends and I went over to his house one day and he had all of these really unbelievable looking plants. In the air in his patio, and they were, some of them were on little pieces of wood or twigs or whatever, and some were just hanging. And I just looked at them, I couldn't believe what I was looking at. I couldn't believe, and what is this? What are these things? And they were plants, and it was so different than anything that I had ever seen. And I've always liked things that were different, you know, something that is challenging, something that is not easily explainable. And so I loved them. And then a few years after I got out of school, I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do when I grew up. And I loved the plants a lot. I looked around and nobody had ever really tried to sell them to the public before. So a friend of mine and I got a Jeep Wagoneer and drove all the way down to Mexico and then into Guatemala and through Guatemala and sent some plants back. And then I came home and I started gluing them on pieces of wood and selling them at the Rose Wool Swap Meet in Arts and Crafts Fair. I did that for 2 years, and I didn't even know there was a Bermudian society, you know, and that's how I started. And then after 2 years, I invited Jerry Robinson to come down. We were together on a diving expedition looking for Spanish galleons down in the Caribbean years before, and he was a real good friend. And he was up in Sacramento, and he came down and worked for a couple of weeks, and now he's been there for 3 years.
We're still growing. How are you growing grounds down in San Diego?
It's pretty impressive. The main nursery that grows the Talanza air plants is in Basel, and it has about a 65,000 square foot greenhouse, about 250 by 360 or whatever it is. And that's where we do the main production for the Talanzas and also the static wood ferns. And then we have another greenhouse there that's 20,000 feet that we grow the Neorginias, like the one that you showed in the Samba. been over in another place, and it's called Rainbow, part of Fallbrook. We have a 70,000 square foot house, and it's where we grow the regular potted vermilias. You know, just one easy for agency to see all the stores. But we also have some plants in there, a lot of stag wort, for example.
Yeah, you know, one of the other things when I was at your nursery there in Barnes,
yeah,
was the stag worts.
Yeah.
Because for years I've been a real stag wort enthusiast. Now I grow wine outdoors. And I'm in the city where I live, it's not this year. And we get cold, it's the solstice, and I don't have a greenhouse. I wish I did, but there's a lot of work to maintain once you get them. So,
if you do it right, though, I mean, that's the whole thing, is if you do it right, technology's come so far.
Yeah, they've got computers to control the humidity and the temperature and everything.
Yeah, materials don't disintegrate. You know, you can stay away from the wood.
Oh, yeah, metals, it's just
metal. Yeah, metal and plastic, and even if it's fresh in greenhouses, so.
Is it always working?
Yeah, and or foam poly, or whatever, but you can do it sort of pretty maintenance-free for quite a while.
One of the problems with bees over the greenhouse is, of course, it's also a great environment for bugs.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of biocontrol going on unless you're introducing it.
Well, we years ago, when we built our first big greenhouse in Basel, the government told us we don't want bugs. I said, okay, well, how do you keep bugs? And we'll keep ants, and how do you keep ants? And we'll use chlorine. So we went around with a big path of chlorine around the whole thing. And we were getting ants, so it was perfect work forever and ever. But then, somewhere in the 90s, I think, was that the government decided they didn't want to have chlorine out on the market anymore because it worked too well. It worked too many years. You know,
it's really long lasting.
Yes, it's really long lasting. They didn't want that. They wanted you to put diazinon in, which is probably illegal now, too.
Well, diazinon is difficult for the market.
Yeah, anything that works is difficult for the market. That's one of the problems.
Well, my problem with diazinon, I don't want to digress from your previous class, but the bird counts. You know, they were spraying out on golf courses and parks on your own turf. And then you get a big flock of birds to land and start feeding.
So that would be a resistance that would take off doing that.
Well, they only from your houses. Well, they did actually. First, they pulled it from indoor use in houses, and then they pulled it from home use exterior. It still is. It's not actually a pulled component for the market. It has a very restricted label for actives. The chlorine problem. It's a pattern I've seen over the years because I'm an agricultural business with a bunch of licenses. And I've always been faced with this regulatory kind of thing. It's just that it's easy to have things get regulated. And, you know, it's a
difficulty.
Well, you know, there's usually some question, there's usually some event that facilitates the problem. And I don't know if it's easy to have 100% food, but the story I got was that, you know, chlorine was injected into the soil primarily for subterranean termite control around houses. Now, the visual use of that down in the south where they're doing experimenting was so effective that they didn't use it. You came back, you slid into subterranean termites because it lasted so long.
That's what I'm at.
And, but then what happened was somebody injected it using a building in Texas. And they injected it through a slab. But they didn't inject it into the soil, they injected it into the ventilation system. Whole building and then what kind of you just tore it down and then you get chlorine in that.
That sounds like a perfect reason to have one.
Well, yeah. So the very, very long residual. I had a little bit of chlorine dust in my house left over my garage. It's marked chlorosis. It's just sitting there, it's interesting. I don't know if I'll ever use it for anything.
Anyway, that's what happened. It worked great for us, and that's how we did
the book. But are you still keeping the ants out with that one treatment?
Is it now, right now, now, now you can't because now it's illegal, you know.
Yeah, you can't buy all these ants.
It's something like that. Now it puts you in jail for 20 years. I mean,
well, it's not like that.
It's nuts. And so, no, you can't. And so, therefore, how do you use orphine? And, you know, you used to use diazinon and then cyanon, and those are gone. So it's a real battle with the ants. I mean, you get rid of them, and then you turn around, and there they are again.
How much do you have as you refer to
them? I don't know which one I'm referring to, because there, I know that we have two basic kinds, and we don't have a lot of ants. We don't have many vermilias. We don't really have that much of a problem with ants. Whiteflies aren't a problem. Slugs and snails aren't a problem. Actually, the plants are very much pest-free compared to other kinds of plants. That's a really cool thing. But they still can't get them stags anymore.
I know, you know, my problem with my stags has always been scaly.
Yeah, the scale's a problem, and mealy advice you could call it, and you get the answer for your minute, you know, so you just, you have to manage it. So I knew that manage it. You can't ever get rid of it. Just manage it.
Or the GA department would be great to be able to go back and come in there and get this thing a real problem.
A firing scheme would be, as you name it.
Oh, yeah, that's all on it. So when you were first bringing plants up from South America back in the 70s, that must have been a lot easier back then than it is today. Because you probably had problems with sizes. Today, trying to go down there in South America and bring back plants today, it's going to be far more challenging than it was 20, 30
years ago. That's true for anything. I mean, in the 60s, you can bring cycads, the biggest tree trunk you've seen them in existence. Again, it's a graph that we're regulating ourselves out of existence. That's
the graph. And one of the problems that happened, of course, was for some species where you stripped.
Well, no, that's true. I'm not arguing that. I'm just saying, you're saying that it's harder to bring stuff in. It is harder to bring stuff in, but there are a lot of different reasons for that. One of which is that governments in general have more power now than they did then, and they're more restrictive. It's easy to do, pass a law, and that's the end of it. And they've done that in a lot of the countries. You know, before, they didn't really care because the plants are weak where they grow. But now, if they see somebody taking something out, there has to be a reason for that. You know, we can outlaw that. And of course, there are seven species that are listed on Appendix 2 of CITES because of Flantia, because they were getting stripped out. The one that was the real legitimate one that is still a problem is the Cisla Xerographica.
So this is a CITES plant?
That's a CITES plant, and that's from Guatemala. And it's kind of like the white elephant of the Flantia group. You don't get carpets of them. They are here and there in trees in desert areas. And they're easy to see. They're easy to collect. They're very attractive. People love them, so they get stripped pretty quickly. And that was the impetus for getting the CITES to finish the CITES pass. And then you run into questions like, well, if we get stripped out of Guatemala, there's still plentiful in Honduras. Do we still want to do this? And then, you know, you get into a lot of questions, but there are out of the 300 or so that are traded, there's seven that are on the CITES now. And this one, what we did, again, we haven't imported anything since 1993, and I bought and we've grown a lot of these Xerographicas from seeds, and it takes about 24 to do this. Is about a 27-year-old plant.
This plant is?
Yeah.
Is there?
Yeah.
A little closer?
Yeah. One, two. And that's what you have to do if you want to get numbers, and you got to go from seeds and move to the zero. So with the bigger ones, like this is a hybrid here that's probably close to 20 years old.
So what was on in the years, what do you sell
about? Yeah, it would be about 35.
That's not bad.
That's not bad.
For the CITES, first of all, a rare and endangered species, which, you know, a lot of people like to grow, but these are rare plants. It's an altruist and
bacterias. Yeah, that's right. And they are just awesome plants.
$35, and will this throw us?
Yes, it will throw, but not a lot. It will have 2 to 4, and it'll take a couple of years to mature. But it's a really easy one.
How will you do that after it blooms? How long does it take to bloom?
This one will bloom for, well, like I said, 25 years or so from the seed to blooming plant. And then it blooms, and the neat thing is it'll bloom for almost a year. From the time you see the inflorescence starting to come out until the time it produces the inflorescence, this one has not yet started to flower. It has beautiful lavender flowers. And until the time it starts really turning brown, it is almost a year. And that's, you know, that's a great thing, and a great reward for, you know, for growing it. So we sell them pretty much as mature plants, but we're also starting to sell them as intermediate, half-grown plants. It will still take a few years before they fully mature. And it's still really fun to watch them grow. It's not like, you know, if they take 25 years, I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to do it. You know, they're really cute, they're really pretty, and you just enjoy the process. You watch them grow, they change every year, they actually grow pretty fast.
And how do I separate off-sets from the steroids?
With the steroids, we do separate the offsets because the bigger plant usually gets pretty ugly after a while and it's large. But with quite a few of them, you know, I didn't have time to cut the dead leaves off of this clump. But, you know, a lot of the clumps actually can grow to be large balls. We had a guy come over to the nursery a few years ago. He was 85 years old. He came over with a big black plastic trash bag. And he had seven clumps the size of volleyballs to basketballs. And the species was called Bear Green. And he had started them from one plant 4 years before. And he was passing them on to us. And now they're, you know, we put them on the rocks, we're never going to sell them on the it's such a cool thing that you can do that with these phones, things like that. There aren't many phones that I know that you can do that where you can get forth. These houses, I mean, all these things happen to players, they never take over, they're always there. They're really easy, and they get bigger over time. And so, you get pretty fast.
This is
Spanish moss, I guess.
Multi-species.
That's the Spanish moss that we originally were talking about.
This moss, probably the smallest room in the paper.
Yep.
And we take a look at it with the overhead camera.
There you go.
Let's see, there it is. And it's
still open to the seed pod.
These are seed pods right here.
That's all the seed pod. The Spanish moss is the stuff that grows all over the trees in the south.
Yeah.
And it actually grows all the way down to Chile and Argentina. And there are some different forms of it. But it's the most ubiquitous, the most successful of all the tilapias because it's in so many places and it grows so easily.
So let's see, this is basically where this would be. I'm not exactly sure how to differentiate what
these so far. Well, these ones leave the problem where your thumb and forefinger are. If you broke it there, that would still grow, so that would be a solid plant.
That's really cool.
Yeah, it is. It's really neat stuff, and it grows terrifically in Southern California. In the trees, and it reproduces pretty quickly, and it sways in the breeze, and it adds a lot of grace. You see the Spanish moss hanging out of the trees in Terra, and you're thinking, oh, this is beautiful, it's just rustic, and it's natural, and all of that, and it does the same thing here. The only difference is you need to be watered once in a while. The air here is pretty dry. The dry air combined with the months we go from rain is the barrier for the plants naturalizing here. So you have to have a hose. It's a hose and balance model. They're fine.
Well,
as we know, if you have that beach, you could water them. Whatever you feel like, it doesn't make any difference. You're in the Simi Valley or South Pasadena. You can hot and dry in the summertime. I would shoot them as frequently as you can because it'll just grow faster. They'll grow faster. I mean, Mark Evan, my friend from UCLA days, was a TA at Riverside in front of a year before he finally had to get his PhD. Now he's at the Arizona Summer Desert Museum in Tucson. He's like,
oh, that's great. That's a great place.
He's been there forever. He loves it. But he was at Riverside for a long time, and he grew tilapias that were the greatest and the biggest that anybody ever saw, and he did it in Riverside. The plants that everybody else grew like this, he would have them like this because he took advantage of the heat. And what he did was, he first of all, he got plenty of direct sun. And he had his hose set up so that he would shoot them with the hose when he went to work in the morning. And tilapias, one of the important things is that once the leaves are wet, more water does not help. Unless you soak it for 12 or 14 hours, that's a different story. You just wet the leaf, and that's it. So you just shoot with the hose when you're done. You don't have to stand there like you're watering your tree or something. You're watering out. You just shoot with the hose when you're done. So you got to set up so he doesn't shoot when you're done. You go to work, come home for it, and go eat soon again. Well, it's the only dry, hot season. And he fertilized them all. And he just grew months.
So you use a week?
You get a whole other discussion about fertilizer, but the main thing is you do not want to have a urea-based nitrogen, which most commercial fertilizers have, because the urea nitrogen is fine, but it needs bacteria in soil to break it down into ammonia nitrogen that the plants can use. So they don't have soil, they don't break it down.
See, nitrogen or ammonia sulfate is
fine. Well, what we did years and years ago is we had a fertilizer made that has just the ammoniacal nitrogen instead of the urea nitrogen. That's what promotes the foliar growth. And it's been out on the market now for about 25 years or so. It works really, really well. So fertilizing is another thing to grow successful plants. Good, real hot, lots of bright light, water, and then fertilize them.
No light fertilization.
Yeah, and just, you don't need much. You don't need much. A lot of people use it just to have it in the water.
So they don't use it for
gravity? Yeah, they use it really quick. I mean, we use about maybe a half a teaspoon per gallon to a quarter teaspoon per gallon.
Yeah, so these fertilizers, the little one would be a tablespoon per gallon.
Yeah, that's right. You use very much, and then you can dilute it down further from that if you want.
So just give it a little bit of food, and that'll take on over the size. I love these influences.
It's called Tilantia cyanea. The color cyan is a blue, and then that's what the color of the flowers are. This has not yet started to flower. The flowers are about the size of a golf ball. They're really big, and they come out from behind each floor, back and forth, all the way up the sides to the top. And they do that for about a month or so.
So these are bracts.
Yeah, those are colorful. Those are fluorescents. This is the inflorescence, and this is the scheme. These are the fluorescents from which the flowers emerge on both sides.
So that's the color of what that is. The bract is wavering.
It's all very yes. And a key for this one is bright light. If you keep it in a real low light area, it will lose some of that pink.
I have a greenhouse window over my kitchen sink on the south side of my house, and I have to shave them because otherwise they just cook everything up.
But that's easy to do.
The problem is by the way my house is the upstairs. Yeah, that's actually the upstairs. But the highest part of the house, it gets very warm up there in the summer. I'll come home, it'll be 85, 90 degrees. Well, maybe it won't get to 90, but it's fine.
As long as it's
healthy. Maybe more importantly. What is this running for this type of
thing? $12 to $15.
Do you want the wood?
Piece of wood is it's interesting. It's California green wood from Northern California.
This is great.
It's very fun. And they're 100 years old. And they all grow in this one area. And they've been using that wood for about 30 years now. And it's going to run out. It's going to run out because now all the great wood is the great wood is grown on the wires. You know, the mechanical pickers come through, so they're losing all their natural character. So they're going to run out one of these days pretty soon. But we still have some of it. And it's just for the size, there's nothing that we've ever seen that's more three-dimensional and attractive than these 100-year-old vines. They're old Fouquet vines.
So that's great. And you know, with Christmas coming up these days, but good for a lot of people, you want to get them an unusual plant for Christmas dinner. You know, you're always thinking of buying something different for Christmas rather than the same thing. That would make a wonderful gift.
This is interesting.
My girlfriend's watching this one, they have a wonderful gift.
On my way over here, South Bay Camellias, the Sisters were actually doing their annual Christmas luncheon today at the nursery. So I went over and I showed the book and said, what have you seen it yet? I said, hi, everybody. And you can bounce the drive from the bathroom and when I get there, you go down where the king car is, where the light is, you make a U-turn, you come back to the right. Of course, there's 1,000 cars waiting to turn left, and it takes 2 or 3 cycles. You know, if you have this great nursery, you park right in front of the greenhouse, you walk in, and there are a lot of people, and it's this beautiful environment. But how do you get the word out? You know, how do people know? You know, first of all, you have the idea that maybe giving somebody a beautiful plant like this would be a really cool gift. And with the plants, is you can put them in a box for a month, and they're okay. You can put it in a box, wrap it up, give it to them a couple weeks later, no big deal. And that's a really neat thing. But people can come in, a lot of people do. But it's amazing how many people go to the malls, fight the traffic, fight the shopping, do all that stuff, and I'm sitting there going, you got over here, man, you got to come over here. So.
Hopefully some of our viewers will take advantage of finding out about your nursery, because I gotta tell you, I've been a lot of nurseries over the years, because now I run the same OPDIF program for Lake County. Every county in California, Oregon, Washington has to do this or our nurseries can't ship out the state. And so and you don't grow in those materials, which makes life easy for you.
Yes. Okay, we have other issues.
The primary purpose of our division in the Ag Commissioner's office is to try and prevent the introduction of new exotic pests. Very, very difficult thing to do, and we try our best. Unfortunately, a lot of people smoke, if you've heard some of the pests, fruit, some avocado. Well, it's been around now for a few years, avocado fruits. They clearly showed that there was smuggled in by some of your father's friends. They found the exact area, probably that they took the cuttings from in Mexico, and smuggled back the cuttings. And you didn't see that there's a little tiny fear of our cuttings. And of course, the word is smuggled. Those of the people who are smuggled
last night, sharpshooter, there's a different fruit flies.
It's harder and harder for us to deal with it. now the stage is filled up on dirt berries, which is probably
what's that?
Dirt berries is considered to root people, and its primary host is citrus. And it also several hundred trees. And we found it down on coral trees in the Long Beach area. And the adult comes up and snouts the edges of the leaves. It's a root. But the grub, which is about an inch and a half or so, feeds on the roots. And then he's kind of spiraling up. And if you've had a feed dog on a lemon tree for very long, you can just go push it through. Just get a bush and falls over. So it's a serious pest.
It's a serious thing.
Yeah, we found it. We found it after they found it in San Diego and Orange County. So we found it in Long Beach and the state found it. Huge money problems. So, and then Asian citrus slowly showed up. And really, there's always so much money to hire so many people to go out and try to control this new pest. So, what happens is now growers are forced to use what they're controls. And so, I met a culprit, which is sold to Merrick. Admire for Craigland, for citrus avocado, vegetable bread. Works pretty good, but it's very difficult to get any clay soils. So if you're on a clay soil, it's harder to work. So they're trying all sorts of stuff. They're trying to bring it in areas they could. And of course, the crops are down in the soil, they need the roots, and they come up, they need a little extra hold of the soil. And they do, the weevil, the adult weevil, crawls on the top. Crawls into the foliage, so it's even foliage. They're using these mats on the surface that will prevent the adults from emerging and going through. That would be a nice way if they can get it to work. They'll prevent it. They can break the cycle of their heads. But that's an expensive thing to do over 100 acres with a lot of trees. So let's take a look at, that's something that is really,
this is a hybrid. The social cluster is that it's amazing. It's actually speaking from your supposed to be
right. This is native to Mexico.
It's
an Italian.
It looks a lot like a species called cotton color, but it is much, much larger than cotton color.
Yeah, and this one's probably quite old too. Maybe
15 years
old. 15 years old. Plus, it'll take about a year for this whole process to bloom.
No. I would say maybe that hasn't started farming either. You would say 6 or 8 months from the time it starts coming up until the time it finishes, but this has already been growing now for 2 or 3 months. So it has another 2 or 3 months to go. And then maybe 2 or 3 months where the color still looks nice. And then the graph will be
helpful.
And it'll also, it's going to have 3, 4, 5, 6 offsets. So that's a good one.
That's nice. And then you can just tie this onto a stump.
You can tie it onto a stump. You can make it in the air. That's what's really cool. It doesn't make any difference. You can put them on anything. As long as they get light and water, that's the key. Light and water, don't let them freeze.
So does that. They did what I
wanted. And there's a starting book out there coming into their time of year where they go and turn their beautiful red. This is a really nice hybrid here. This one is actually one of the first hybrids of this name. And it's called Eric Milblock. It was named after Guyana, Louisiana. It was made in the 60s. And it's a hybrid of Rocky Collis and Sergeant Phillip. And Rocky Collis is another one that does not have an inflorescence. So this one, the inflorescence won't come up when you start to fill it. Does. It'll just come up a little bit, and then it'll have a beautiful purple flowers. But it has a terrific shape. It has a beautiful color on the leaves. Very graceful.
It actually looks like it has a tang.
It does. And
this all it does is really have a tang.
No, but I mean, if you look at the Acosti, if you look at the xerographica here, the xerographica, this will probably be almost a quart of water. One of the tricks with growing these plants, and this is something important to mention to your viewers, is that with the bromeliads, if they're indoors, you don't really want to have too much water in the cup. Because when people kill them, the way they most frequently do that is because the water in the center gets stagnant, the bacteria gets started, and then the whole center rots and comes out and smells of rotten eggs. And it's because they have the same water in there for a long time.
Over pour out the water
or not use too much. If you for the green typical common bromeliads, if you use bottled drinking water or rain water rather than tap water, that helps a lot. And don't put a whole lot in the cup of water, rather the soil. And if you do it every couple of weeks, that's about all you need to do. It's not a whole big deal. the center part, the influence water, basically it used up where evaporation dries out and stays dry for 2 or 3 days, and even the tree will die. And that's great, and then you just start over again. So, you know, with vermilions and house like that, you water every couple of weeks, mostly you water the soil. So, it's just the same thing. You don't want to leave the water in the cup and let it get stagnant. That's the thing. And the same with outside, you water the soil down a little bit, make sure they get flushed in their fur.
And, now, I wanted to ask you a couple more questions about your home, because you're starting to do your thing, so
we won't get to my. I was in China earlier, so I was in China, and then I went to Singapore, and I have a great vermilion group in Singapore, and some beautiful botanical gardens. They're actually building a multi-billion-dollar botanical gardens by the day. I mean, you go over there, you know, you want to get into politics, but you're watching the wealth from our country transfer to Asia, and we're all watching this process happen. And you go over there, and they have square miles of construction cranes everywhere. It's unbelievable how different it is over there. And they're doing everything with this billions of dollars to spend on building the botanical garden. And they do.
They are, actually.
They bought us when they got in Australia, and they got a guy from the cities here. But anyway, so I was over there, and they air couriered over 2 copies that they hand bound. So I was at some meetings and gave talks and things, and so I wanted to be able to have that to sort of show off.
How long did you write this book?
I worked on it a lot the last year. The book I did in 87 was my Nights and Weekends for 4 years. And that served as the foundation for this book, although a lot of this book is new. And but a lot of it also is from before, so I was really glad I didn't have to do the research
start over.
But I think photography and the plants that are in front
of it. Take a quick look.
Yeah, if you start at the front, I mean, the Murderer's Row is kind of at the front. And then start with the next page. And page after page is going to have a beautiful photograph.
Similar to the pages listed on our overhead camera. And here's your first color plate.
Yep.
And so, oh, look at that. Who do you do photography?
Do you see the irony? Yes, it's digital. Well, the ones that from the first book obviously was analog. It was a hustle of this time I used it.
This is your waterfalls that you're
putting in. Another part of the waterfalls of Point Pines here in the nursery in Torrance.
Look at it. So, what's the zero?
With the plastic, it's going to have clear plastic dust jacket cover, so it'll stay pristine for years. That was something that was big because of the black cover. It was $70. It's about 310 pages. And beautiful cloth cover for it. And lots of neat photos. But the main thing is the information. Employees felt like whether or not the book will stand the test of time is based on the text, is the color that photographs will sell the book, and then the text is what will keep it up there in the front ranks.
Well, this is a must-have for my library.
It's, yes, it's I hope for it.
Yes, here's the wrong markers.
There's Bulbosa. Classers, and it turns red when it flowers. Hey, you can see the purple flowers on there.
That's nice.
Yeah, that's nice. And I also want to mention that this weekend coming up, this weekend, we're having a huge sale in the nursery. Twice a year, maybe, but we'll have a huge Christmas holiday sale.
So, coming up today's the 6th, so it's going to be
Saturday and Sunday.
Saturday is the 12th and 13th.
Yeah, Saturday will be like 9 to 5, and Sunday will be 10 to
3. You press on Hawthorne.
19121.
19121 Hawthorne in Torrance is just south of 190.
There's a 100 yard south of 190. Yeah, on the west side of the street.
Even if you don't want to buy it and go down and take a look at this garden. Because you've got a great parking lot to boot.
Yeah, so anyway, I will be there and if anybody wants to
come, just do the car on your parking lot.
Yeah.
Because when you pull in, you've got a big collection of euphorbia stored in your parking lot. You have a whole bunch of outdoor books. There are large libraries, but not the
other Psychics and the big aloe
PGI. Oh, yeah, just aloes, you know. those quality informants.
There's actually a lot of stuff there.
That's the main extension of the Botanical Garden,
yes.
It's really unusual to see.
It's for seed, and you know, people will come from, down by the border, they'll come from Calhoun, San Luis Obispo, they'll just come.
Hopefully,
it is made for people to know that it's there. Basically, just nobody knows that it's there.
We got a group today, pretty educated about your really unique garden. What do you agree in your soil?
my roommate in the fraternity loved economics. I didn't start taking econ classes. By the time I decided I hated economics, I only needed one or two more classes and I was done. So I made it an econ. I was managing the football team for a couple of years. Got to travel.
Oh, that was so
funny. It really was. It was back in the days during even Tommy Crothero and OJ and all that stuff. Very fond memories of those days. I really majored in a liberal education. I wanted to take as many different kinds of classes as I could. You know, I wanted to take college as a way to sort of spread out the platform from which you live the rest of your life. You know, I've always felt like you need three big planks. You need education, and you need the reading. You need to read a lot because not everything that exists is in reading. And then you got to travel. You got to go out and see what the world looks like. You got to see how other people do things, you know, because if you don't know anything, then you have to depend on what people tell you on TV. So if you do that, and you start when you're young, probably many times better than never. You know, that's
it's easier when you're young,
but the worst thing, you know, when I was about 15, I had a dream, I pictured myself to be about 80 years old, and I was looking back at my life, and I was thinking, I'm proud of my life, I like my life, what's my life like? You know, I found out that what I really wanted, what I really appreciated was seeing life and adventure. You know, going out to see what's actually out there, not snapping fingers. And back when I was 15, but when I was in Edgerton, I realized that if I didn't start my career until I was 30, and by the time I was 80, I'd be the same place as everybody else. But I would have gotten to do all this really cool stuff in my 20s. You know, before you have the spouse, before you have the career, and all that, before you're locked in, I got to work and all those really cool things. This is how I met Jerry on the diving expedition and all of that. And it was in that adventure period when I was 26 that I got the idea for the plants. So for me, it started when I was 26. I was 26 on a Marquise volleyball, drinking beer on the beach. It was a 7 days where it would be 3 years to get the thing going.
Well, you know a little bit about my background. I went to Cal Poly for a little bit, and that might be why.
Right.
Went out to UC where I got a PhD in biopathology. But I did that in my 30s.
Yeah, so you can do it anytime.
So, you know, I had gone to Cassia City College, taking a whole bunch of classes, and was blown laws all over Pasadena, and didn't make a lot of blown laws, so I'm coming trees, and they can charge more for that.
Exactly.
And then I thought, I took a biology class for liberal arts majors, but the biology was much more fun than history and English. So it completely got me into biology and then botany, and one of the things I've always enjoyed. Also, when I was out taking care of someone's farm, and they what were they growing? And a lot of these people, I had in common friends were, actually elderly, a lot older women, and they had fabulous gardens. They would tell me all sorts of great stories about all the plants that grew. I always remember, it's funny when you remember what you forget. I always remember one of my plants grew full size dahlias, the size of dinner plants. And I was just so taken by those dahlias. And you see all of the dahlias hung now that are all treated to dwarf them. And they're nice, they're at least a nice bedding plant, but they also do. Those full size dahlias growing the fabulous size of it.
Well, it's interesting for me because my path was so different. I wanted to see what was out there, all the different things. And I just stumbled onto the Tillysies by accident. And I do not consider myself, obviously I'm not professionally trained. And once you get out of what I know, I am not horticulturist. I don't know a lot about a lot of things. I mean, I'm a psychiatrist. I know the bromeliads and some of the orchids and the stems. There are some things that you don't know about. Plantes, I'll put myself in the gold medal room. You want to go for it? I'll do it.
That's
what I do. But, and there's so much in nature that's so beautiful, so much in the world that's so beautiful. You know,
I got an opportunity to live in Europe on and off over the years. Wondering, I mean, this may surprise you, it may surprise some of our viewers, is actually before I went back to college, I was a ballet dancer.
Really?
And I started dancing when I was about 12 years old. Started taking ballet classes. What really deep my interest was, I was literally born in a room with 30 girls wearing leotards and ties.
That was fun. That was fun. I remember those days.
And then once I was 18, I ended up in a studio in Beverly Hills in order to create a professional ballet company. So I started doing performances with them. I was standing up very tall, very quickly. So they had me standing behind girls holding me. But I met people, they invited me to come to Europe and dance at their ballet companies.
Wow.
I moved to Holland when I was 18. I came back, danced locally, went back to Germany in the early 80s. I came back from Germany, and then I was in my 30s, and really, that's, most people don't dance, you know, so it's time to be a real train, so I went back. But I want to thank you for coming on the show today.
One of my most interesting events that I've had in the game, so forever, so it's
all nicely, in his new book, Clarencius. It's not out and available yet, but still,
it'll be, we'll have it hopefully by Christmas.
Right around Christmas. Okay. Well, this is the last show of our semester. I want to thank our crew who have been here every Sunday. You don't get to see Angie Guardano, thank you. Alfredo Leal, Nicholas Payne, and Brittany Arini, and Fidel Garcia. I want to thank them for all their hard work, and I also want to thank our senior producer, Dan Bridget, and our executive producer, Warren Ashton. These are the people behind the scenes that make this whole station go, and without them, the screen would be dark. So, thank you all for your hard work, and we're running out of time. We'll be back on the air January 24th, and we'll be talking about a whole bunch of things, especially vegetable gardening, because it'll be time to get your summer vegetables in January, or at least preparing for them, because by the end of the month, you'll be looking for that. So, looking forward to seeing you again. Thank you again, Paul, for coming on the show.
Well, thank you.
I'll come by your nursery next week.